Today I have a message to share with you. And it's in the Body Language series, and we're talking about body language, but it is a little different than maybe you're anticipating. You need to put on your spiritual thinking cap today. And I want you to turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 3. And I really want you to listen carefully to the words that Paul writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. There is, when Paul wrote to churches, he generally wrote because they were having some type of issue, some type of challenge that they didn't know what to do. And so he wrote a lot of stuff to them. To the Corinthians, they were messing everything up. And to the Colossians, they were being challenged with the deity of Jesus Christ. And obviously to the Romans, they were struggling with salvation and some of the Jews and stuff like that. But there's one epistle that Paul wrote that we do not pick out any particular sense that there's something going wrong in it. And it is probably some of his greatest theology in all the Bible that gives us some background, some understanding to who we are as a body of believers, and that is the letter to the Ephesians. It is high, 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 high theology. It's one of the most difficult books to understand and one of the most difficult to deliver in message. But it also carries with it some of the greatest truths that there are. So I want you to read with me, beginning in verse 8. Listen to what Paul says. He says, "To me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace was given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ." Paul was a singular person who had a singular job that had never been given to anybody else until him. Now listen to what he was called to do. He says this, "To make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ." Why? Why was this given him? "To the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church," or if I could insert the word body, "by the body of Christ, to the principalities and to the powers in the heavenlies." Now, why did God want Paul to do that? Listen to verse 11. "It was according to," and here's probably two of the most important words you'll ever read in the Bible. It's the only time it is ever said. "It is according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord." Father, thank you today for always blessing us with every spiritual blessing that there ever could be in the person of Jesus Christ. Thank you for that. Father, help us today to understand something of your eternal purpose. And may it change us and shift us in so many ways. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I don't know how far I'm going to make it. I always bring far more than I have ability to share. But I'm going to try. With those thoughts in mind, with the verses that you heard in mind, I want to read a few other verses that will just kind of set your focus on where I want you to be thinking today. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. You don't have to turn there, but just listen to the words. Everybody knows what this says, but sometimes we don't actually get what it says. And Romans 8 and verse 28 says this, "We know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose." What purpose? In Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 11, Paul said this. He wrote these words. He says, "In him," in Christ, "who also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his own will." In 2 Timothy, as Paul is writing again, he makes these statements. He says, "Do not be ashamed of me," verse 8 through 11. He says, "Do not be ashamed of me and the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings of Christ for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us, and he has called us with a holy calling, not according to our works." He did not say anything about sin. He said, not according to our works, not according to anything that we have done, not whether Adam and Eve sinned in the garden or whether we've done good or bad. He said, this is not something God did as a result of mankind at all. He says, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus, listen carefully, before time began. Before time began. There appears to be something that God himself was planning on doing before we fell in the garden. Isn't it interesting that the Bible starts at Genesis 1, not Genesis 3? And most of our Christianity seems to begin at Genesis 3 with the fall of mankind and the redemption of mankind and the covenant that God made concerning Jesus Christ. And it challenges us to go, challenges me anyway, to go back and to say, why did God even write Genesis 1 and Genesis 2? Was it so that we would have some understanding of creation versus evolution? Is that the purpose of those two chapters? I don't think so. I don't think that they have anything to do with creation evolution. Creation is an obvious thing, and God gave that to us. But I don't think that those passages, those chapters were there so that we would be able to defend that. They're there for a radically different reason, which in weeks to come, I'm going to be sharing out of those chapters and share some really powerful stuff with you. But today I want to talk about God's eternal purpose in reference to the body of Christ. Whenever I read passages like this, let me share what goes through my mind. I wonder sometimes, I mean, that's an incredible verse of scripture. But I wonder, what do these verses, how do they relate to people in church who are struggling, who are having a hard time paying their bills, who are struggling raising their children, who are maybe having difficulty in the workplace, or they're trying to juggle their busy schedules, or maybe they're grappling with some powerful temptation or sin. How does that help them? What does that do for them? I mean, thinking about God's eternal purpose, that may be great for theologians and for philosophers, but how does it affect those of us who are wrestling with the everydayness of life? Does it really do us any good? Well, whenever I read something like that, I have to first assume that Paul must have known that the people that he was speaking to were just like us. They weren't any different than we are. Now, they may not have had the media bombarding them with worldly temptations. Maybe they didn't have mortgages to pay, but I know what they did. They did have the common everyday situations that all people face in life. So Paul must have thought that somehow this would help these people to be able to live better if they could understand something about why they were here. Something about, did it make a difference depending on what situation or circumstance they were in? Did it make a difference if they were here, if they knew why, if they knew what they were doing? I can remember when one of my first jobs that my dad helped me to get, I was going to be in a repair business, and he took me in and he allowed me to meet the owners and he allowed me to go through the whole, he wanted me to know the whole operation, because he felt like that if I knew the whole operation, that the part that I was going to be doing, that I would be able to do it so much better, so much more effectively and efficiently, and with a sense of purpose and meaning if I knew how it fit into the larger whole. So he wanted me to know. I think that Paul also wanted the same thing. So how do the truths that Paul sets forth here help us to live purposefully in the light of all that's going on in our lives, the things that we struggle with today? What prompted Paul to write these things in the first place? Well, as I thought about that, it seems to me that what Paul is doing is trying to raise our vision for what God is doing in his church and what God is doing with his church. He is showing us that his church is not part of his vision, but it is actually the central thing of his vision. See, when I was in seminary, they told me in seminary that God did a whole lot of stuff, and I'm going to briefly, God did a whole lot of stuff, and then there's this thing called a parenthesis, known as the church, that nobody really knew about. There's this little parenthesis, and God's going to do a little bit here and a little bit there with the church for a little time, and then he's going to take us out, and he's going to finish up doing what he's doing. And that's really kind of been my mindset for a long, long time, that, hey, there's a lot that went on here, and there's still a lot that's got to go on there, and for this little parenthesis of time, that God is going to do something with his body, the church. I have since found that that's not true in its fullest measure. See, all too often, because of things like that, I think that believers, many believers, view church as maybe nice, you know, if it's a relatively good church or friendly church. We got our name tags on today, and we didn't have time to do a welcome, but, you know, make sure you call each other by name. That it's kind of nice, but rarely is the church essential or necessary. Many who claim to be born again really view the church as optional. I can't tell you the numbers of conversations that I've had with people that said, you know, if I'm out in my boat fishing, I'm communing with God, and that's perfectly all right. And they view this thing as it's just optional. It's not really necessary to be in a church. Now, if it meets our needs, then fine. But if it doesn't, there's really no need to bother with it. It's really not that important in the overall scheme of things anyway. It only matters whether or not we are saved. Of course, if you look at the church, the body of Christ, in the context of the world, you'll recognize that the church wouldn't make the list of the top 50 most important needs in America today by any stretch of the imagination. We would never even get in that top 50. And that marginalizing of God's body, it kind of seeps into our thinking so that we miss God's perspective and his priority on the church. You see, in reality, what matters to God is the church. In fact, it's number one on his top 50 list. Absolutely number one. Because it is essential to his eternal purpose. In fact, you ever thought about the statements where the Bible says that it is Christ who is building his church? How much more important can something be that the Son of God is the one engaging in doing the thing in the first place? It is quite essential. God's eternal purpose centers on Jesus Christ and on his church. And if we want our lives to truly mean something for eternity, to truly count in eternity, we're going to have to get God's vision and God's purpose on this thing, his church, his body, and what it's all about. Perhaps you've heard the story of a gentleman who was going past a construction site every day, and he continually was wondering what they were building because they didn't have a sign out front to tell what it was. And so one day he decided he would stop and he would ask some people what they were building. So he pulls up to one guy and he asks his first worker, "What exactly are you doing? What are you building?" And the worker stopped for a moment and said, "I'm chiseling stone." Well, the guy wasn't overly satisfied with that reply, so he went to another worker. And as he came up to that other worker, he was still eager to know. And so he asked him a question again, "What are you doing?" And this worker said, "I'm earning a living. What does it look like I'm doing?" Well, he still wasn't greatly satisfied with that conversation, so he went to a third man, and he asked his third worker, he said, "Sir, what are you doing?" And this man dropped his sledgehammer. He stood up erect with a gleam in his eye, and he says, "I am building a great cathedral." All three men were doing exactly the same job, but only one of them saw their role as it fit into the larger plan, the larger purpose, the larger vision. And Paul wants us to see how our lives fit into God's eternal purpose in church. And when we see this, it'll help us to place sometimes our difficult trials and difficult struggles, because look there in verse 12 and 13 of 1 Corinthians or Ephesians chapter 3, he says this. After verse 11, after saying, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through faith in him, therefore, And he's telling us this for a reason. He says, therefore, I ask that you do not lose heart in my tribulations for you, which is for your glory. What was going on? There are distractions in life. There are things that all of us deal with. Everybody may have something different, but they're similar. There's no temptation such as not common to man. And so all of us have distractions. There's something going on in our life. And that distraction can turn us away from something that's far more important. Paul is writing this letter from prison under the threat of death. And because of that, these believers, and obviously Timothy is the pastor of this church and a major compatriot there of the Apostle Paul, and they have deep concern for him, and they want to be able to help him. He says, I don't want you to be concerned for me. I don't want you to change what you're doing for me. I don't want any of that. How different is it from those who say, how you doing today? Oh man, my back is hurting and my legs are hurting and I got a bad headache and I'm out of money and all this kind of stuff. Paul says, listen, I don't even want to talk about the kind of junk that's going on in my life. I do not count the tribulations and trials in my life to even come anywhere near the glory for the things that are going to be coming to us. This is unworthy of a conversation. I want to elevate for you what is really going on here within the context of the church of Jesus Christ. As Paul attempts to comfort and encourage the Ephesians, he does not do it as we would do it. In fact, he doesn't begin with the fall of man. He doesn't begin with the cross of Christ. He doesn't begin with our salvation or our realm of eternity in heaven. He begins with our eternal Father, and he begins with the purpose that was established before the foundation of the world, before the temptation in the garden, before the call of Abraham, before the law of Moses. He takes us all the way back. Paul wants the Ephesians to realize, as well as us, to realize that God's eternal purpose was determined in the heart of God before the world was made. Not because man sinned. God did not send Jesus Christ because we sinned. God sent Jesus Christ because this was his plan from the beginning. This was something he was doing long before that. Let me help you understand what I mean. Let's say, for example, that I was a model. I know that's hard to imagine. But let's say that I was going to be a model and I was going to be photographed for all types of things. And my face was extremely important in that modeling situation. And this was my parents' plan from the very beginning. But then what happened to me, I was 11 years old, I got burned and I got marred in my look. And so like, well, we're going to get the finest doctors and the finest surgeons and the best plastic surgery and everything that you can imagine to fix what was going on with your face so that we can get you back to what we had originally planned, which was for you to be a model. You see, God saved us and redeemed us not so that would be the end all, not so that that would be the end goal of life, not so that we could say, well, I'm saved, I'm in, everything's good, I can go on about my business, I've got my ticket punched, everything's fine now. Let me just move on. That is not why God saved you. God saved us and put us together in a body because he had a purpose for us from the beginning. We got messed up in the middle of that process and he fixed it so that we could get back to being about the thing that we were supposed to be doing in the first place. And this plan was accomplished and this plan was determined by the Father long before anything else ever happened. So we've got to get some grasp on what this whole thing is. What is this all about? That's exactly how God presented this in the Bible whenever he wrote Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2, because he wanted to establish this purpose before he talked about our fall. And this is a crucial understanding, because if we understand it according to man's sin, Genesis chapter 3, then all of our faith and all of our Christianity becomes man-centered, as if the only reason God came here was for us, that it's all about us. It's all about what we need. It's all about him meeting our needs. It's all about everything that we want, rather than understanding, no wrong, it's all about him. It really is all about God and something that God himself wants. And if we don't do it right, then we'll place salvation as our end goal of everything. And we'll have for the church its end goal as evangelism is the end goal of the church, rather than understanding that God has a far greater purpose than just evangelism. Now, I'm not trying to diminish that. I'm just saying that there's something greater there. When we read here in Ephesians chapter 3, what we find and discover is that God's eternal purpose is to make known his manifold wisdom through his church. That there's something that God wants to be made known, and that is him. But he's going to use something to do it. Now, let me try to illustrate. If I were to try to prove to you that I was strong, and I were to grab this air right here and do this, do some curls, would y'all believe that I was strong? I think most of you can curl air, can't you? Amen. Most of you can. Men, women, boys, and girls, all of you can curl air. And so if I'm curling air and I'm telling you guys that I'm strong, you might say, well, who can't do that? But if I were to get some really heavy dumbbells up here that none of you could lift, and I were then to lift them, it would show you in a way that you could see and understand my strength. If you came and tried to, whoa, can't do that. That Pastor Kenny, he's really strong. So we need something to see. And what's so amazing about God is that how can God show himself, not to you and me, to the principalities and to the powers that are in the world, that are in the heavenlies, that are around? How does God make himself known? For a long time, before we ever got here, before the world was ever created, when there was nothing here, God made a determination that he was going to reveal himself, and that he was going to do it through a very specific means, and that in making this plan come to action, that it was going to come to action at a very specific time. Things were going to go on before this time ever happened, but there would be a specific time and a specific person who would make this known, and there would be a body who would be used in the process of doing that. Not only now, but for the remainder of eternity. Not for a parenthesis, not for a little short time, not until the rapture comes, but from now until forever. That God is going to take this body, the church of Jesus Christ, and he is going to manifest himself. Now, this is not an easy topic to engage in. Or to introduce. So let me try to break it into five pieces to help you understand, okay? Number one, we need to establish the fact that God has an eternal purpose. I'm not going to put a lot on the board other than just phrases. We have to establish that God has an eternal purpose. Flip your Bible over to Ephesians chapter 1. You should be right there anyway. To Ephesians chapter 1, verses 9 through 12. I'm telling you, chapter 1 take years to really understand, but quickly, listen to what God wrote through the Apostle Paul. He says, God having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. Now here's this thing that he wants to make known to us, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, which simply means at a time that God has chosen, that he understands is exactly the right time to do this, that he might gather together in one, that's one body, one group of believers, that's the church, that he might gather together in one all things in Christ. So here it focuses mainly on Jesus Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him, that is Jesus. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ, that's the church, should be to the praise of his glory. So as Paul sort of unfolds this eternal purpose that he's got going on here, he wants us to understand that God's eternal purpose is to sum everything up that there is, heaven and earth and everything that there is, to sum everything up in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. There is nothing more important than Jesus. One of the reasons that we pound and pound and pound and pound so hard that you must believe in Jesus is because God has encapsulated everything in his Son. Now, I'm not talking about the Mormon Jesus. I'm not talking about the Jehovah's Witness Jesus. I'm not talking about the Muslim Jesus. I'm talking about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, that he has encompassed everything in him. The Old Testament looks forward to Christ. The New Testament testifies of him. And all history will climax whenever he returns in power and glory to reign. And since Jesus is the head of his body, the church becomes central to the very purpose, the eternal purpose of God. If Jesus wanted to make something else central to that, he would have been the head of something else. He could have been the head of an organization. He could have been the head of Rome. He could have been the head of the United States. He could have been the head of a corporation. But instead, he chose to become the head of a body, his body, that makes us central to who he is. And this body is a body that has been brought together in one, both Jews and Gentiles, dropping all of our human distinctions, dropping all of our fleshly distinctions, because it's not about us, it is about him. We have become central to who he is. Paul says in verse 8 that in his ministry, in addition to preaching to the Gentiles these unsearchable riches of Christ, that he is also to bring to light the fellowship of this mystery, which for all ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Christ Jesus. So people in the Old Testament, they didn't know about us. They didn't know that there was going to be this kind of a body. They didn't know that. It was hidden, and God was the one who had hidden it. Now, to really understand what God is trying to say here in regard to this eternal purpose, one key to understanding here is to understand who is it that we're to be manifesting things to. And according to Scripture, God wants us to reflect to the principalities and to the powers that are around us. And so we're not the actual audience. I said at the Lord's Supper, the angels are peering in here. They're the ones paying attention. They're the ones looking. They're the ones that are watching. They are our audience. Amen. These are the people that God's trying to display something to. He's going to display it to them because he's given himself to us. And he has chosen to indwell us. He has chosen to make us his body. But he's trying to show something out there. And he's trying to elevate our understanding of actually who we are as a church. Number two, God's eternal purpose was a mystery hidden for the ages, but it's now been revealed to us through the Apostle Paul. The mystery of Christ refers to an eternal plan that God had to sum up everything in Christ as the Savior. But one of the parts of that mystery that was previously unknown was this whole situation of the Jews and Gentiles coming together. And you can tell that it's still a mystery to many of us because we still all seem to hang on to all of our racial distinctives, to all of our cultural distinctives, to all of our sexual distinctives, to everything that there is. And we've not yet grabbed a hold of this understanding of, in fact, who we are in Jesus Christ. This was all hidden. And God says, I'm going to take this one man, the Apostle Paul, and I am going to use him to begin to reveal these teachings and these truths. This is why the letters of Paul are so crucial to us, not just in understanding what Jesus said and what Jesus did, but understanding why did Jesus do what he did and why did he do it the way that he did it. The Old Testament predicted the salvation of a lot of Gentiles, but it never did reveal that God wanted to unite them in a singular body, and that the Jews and the Gentiles would have equal standing, equal footing, equal value, even to the Jews. That is why you would understand that the Judaizers, whenever they started pushing out in their missionary endeavors, felt like that the Gentiles needed to become Jews. That they had to be circumcised and they had to adhere to the law of God. They never understood that. For some of us, we still have not understood the unity that we're supposed to have in Christ. Number three, I got to go really fast. God's eternal purpose was carried out through Jesus Christ. It is not carried out through us, it is carried out through Christ. This is a finished action. Through his death, through his resurrection, it was at the cross especially that God demonstrated his manifold wisdom. Now, try to imagine if I wanted to tell you that somebody was heroic, that I know a person in our church and he is really or she is really heroic, how would you know that? There are pictures that are etched in my mind. I remember when an airline went off the end of a runway in Washington and went into the river, into the Potomac. It was freezing. There was ice all over the place. If you're old enough, you'll remember this. They had helicopters out there trying to pluck people out of the river. They were dying in the river as they were freezing to death in the river. There was a group of people that were around a large chunk of ice, and they were trying to get into a helicopter. And there was this one man that he got up on the ladder, and he looked down, and he climbed back down the ladder, and he began to take people and push them up to the ladder. And when he pushed the last person up onto the ladder to get into the helicopter, he went under the water, and he died. Now, he was one of the first to get to the ladder, but he realized, no, I need to help these ladies. I need to help these guys. That guy was a hero. We would not have known that prior to that day. But there was something that displayed his heroism. There was something that allowed us to see that heroism. Here's a question. How do you know that God is loving? How do you know that God is merciful? How do you know that God forgives? How do you know that God is a God of grace? How do you know that? Do you know that because we read it in a book? I've read a whole lot of things in a book, and I've read behind a lot of guys in books and gals in books, but that doesn't mean that what they say about themselves is really true. On television, they will tell you, buy my book and you'll become a millionaire. I'll be there to help you, but how do you know that? The only way to know that is for it to be displayed. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5 and verse 8, God manifested, God demonstrated, God showed us his love. And the way that he showed that to us was by his son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, not as we were trying to do something good, not as we had climbed a ladder of accomplishment in the world, but while we were still sinners, Jesus Christ died for us. If there is anything that the angels are like, who is this God? I mean, he keeps telling us about himself, but who is he really? And God says, I am going to make a way for you to see who I am. And when Jesus Christ came down here and became a man, when he laid down his attributes, Philippians chapter 2, and laid down those attributes, the angels, all of them, both good and bad angels, peering down and watching what he was doing and stepping into the flesh of a man, sinless flesh, yes, but into human flesh, what is he doing? Who would do something like that? And then to live as a man and to lay down his attributes and then to go to death for something he did not do, to be spat upon for something he did not do, to be whipped for something he did not do, to be crucified for something he did not do. But he was telling you, listen, I love you. And you don't believe that I love you. I'm going to show you that I love you. and I'm going to show you how much I love you. You know what Paul said? He said, I only wish to God that you guys could comprehend with all of the saints what is the length and the depth and the breadth and the height of the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, if you even knew what that was. And so for the angels to be peering in whenever they watched the burial, when they watched the incarnation, when they watched the birth, when they watched the life, when they watched the trial and the scourging and the death and crucifixion and then ultimately the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it tells them something about God that could not be known any other way. And God wanted us to know that. And Jesus carried out that eternal purpose. And not only that, the angels who would have known God and who would have known much about him for however long that they were here to recognize that the only way that that sacrifice could be made, it would have to be an infinitely holy sacrifice apart from all sin. And for Jesus to be the only one that was able to do it, even when all of us are redeemed, even when all of us have been saved, even when all of us are in heaven and it comes time to break the seals on the scrolls, there is still only one worthy in heaven to be able to do that, and that is Jesus Christ. And there again is another way of displaying to the principalities and powers who this God is. Number four, God's eternal purpose is to make known his manifold wisdom to the rulers and to the authorities in heavenly places. I think most of us rarely give attention to angels, that we don't think about them a whole lot. But Paul brings them into the center of God's eternal purpose. We know that the angels are in the presence of God. We know that there are fallen angels. We know that that God's at war with certain ones of the angels. We know that the holy angels were especially involved in the praising of God. We know that the angels were the announcers that whenever at the birth of Jesus Christ and very involved in that. We know that the angels were there at the crucifixion and right there ready to be at Christ's beck and call if need be. And we know that the angels are curious about us, that they want to look into this thing called salvation, the book of Hebrews reminds us. They have such a special interest in us that in 1 Corinthians a few weeks ago I shared with you that God says, hey, the reason that there needs to be coverings, the reason there needs to be authority, the reason there needs to be submission, the reason that a woman should have long hair, the reason that a man should not have a covering on his head is because of the angels. Because they're looking at us. They're paying attention to us. They're thinking about us. We know that the angels together with us one day will sing praises to God. And to the fallen angels which exist, the church exists to show Christ's triumph at the cross and display this great wisdom that God reminds them of their impending doom. In verse 10, he says, to the intent that the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and to the powers. Number five. By the way, I've skipped about 90% of my message because I just don't have time. But I'm going to come back and expand this stuff. I promise. This is more of an introduction. God's eternal purpose is to make his wisdom known through his church for all ages. In verse 10, he says, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, according to his eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, listen, my favorite passage of scripture in all the Bible, Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. He says this, now to him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that works within us. Listen to verse 21. To him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. So let it be. It is the church that is God's solo plan as the body of Christ for the reconciled universe of the future. The mystery of God's will administered in Jew and Gentile pulled together at a very specific time in history. is God's plan for making, for displaying himself on the silver screen as it is. He adds that the church created by God, putting these two together, are going to be his agent for this reconciliation. We're the ones that are going to be the showing the wisdom of the principalities, wisdom to the principalities and the powers, by being the church that God created us to be. John Piper, an incredible author and a man with great insight and wisdom, wrote these words. He said, "We usually don't hit targets that we're not aiming at. And the target for the church is to demonstrate to the evil powers of the cosmos that God has been wise in sending his son, that we might have hope and be unified in one body, the church. Therefore, when we fail to live in hope and to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, we send the signal through the galaxies that God's purpose is failing and that he was not wise, but was in fact foolish." Again, the overall point that Paul is driving home is to elevate our understanding of the importance of the church in God's eternal plan, so that we'll give it proper priority in our lives. He wants us to understand what a great privilege it is to be part of the chosen people of God as the agents to carry out this eternal purpose in the heavenlies. The church is not just a nice place to drop by if everything is going all right. It is the essential vehicle that God is using to make known his manifold wisdom. And if we don't do that, we make God look like an idiot. Now here's a question. When God extended his grace and his mercy into this body, and he says, "Hey, I want you to look." Now, if I could just put a thought in your mind and a story in your mind that you're very familiar with, you'll understand what I'm talking about. If there's anybody who can represent this well in Scripture, it would be Job. When Satan came by and he's like, you know, he's got all kinds of accusations against the brethren. And it was God who said, "Have you considered my servant Job?" And Satan said, "Well, you won't let me touch him. He's hedged about by all kinds of stuff. You won't let anything happen to him." And God says, "I'll tell you what I'll do. You can't kill him. I'll take my hand, but you can't kill him. You can't do that. But you try. He will show you who I am." And as Satan came after Job, and he came after his family, and he came after his health, and he came after all kinds of things, but he never, never, never cursed God. Even whenever his wife was after him to curse God and die, he would not do it. He surrounded him with friends that did nothing but say, "Job, you've got to be a sinner. There is no way that God would ever allow something like this to befall you unless, of course, you have done something wrong." Only to realize that God was saying, y'all got this thing backwards. Job was here to manifest the glory of God, the power of God, the magnitude of who God was. And God says, when he's successful, and he will be, I'll give him back everything that he's lost double. And he did. Now, could you imagine if God, looking down on the church, and why did Paul write this? He says, guys, listen, you guys are so discouraged in your walk. You're so discouraged in the world. You're so discouraged by your finances. You're discouraged by your family. You're discouraged by your marriages. I need to let you know something. I want you to think about this kind of like Job. When stuff is going wrong, don't curse God. Do you not understand? If you do that, there are people watching, and they are the principalities and the powers, and they are looking to us to magnify who God is. Now, when we think about this in the context of how we operate as a body, when we bite one another, when we criticize one another, when we walk away from one another, when we quit, when we give up, when we won't support, when we don't give, we make God look like an idiot. For dying for us. God says, "I have blessed you with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies in Christ." And I have created you, and I wrote it in my book, for this is my eternal purpose. This is not for a short period of time. This is what I thought about when I thought about making you in the first place. This was the reason that I did it. And there is, I'm unsearchable. I'm God, I'm unsearchable. For all of eternity, you'll be finding out who I am. But because you're not God, you don't have the capacity to understand God. So I am going to have to make tangible ways for you to see, tangible ways for you to understand. And throughout all of eternity, I'm going to do it in my body, with Christ as my head. Now, folks, we have the opportunity. We have the opportunity to embrace that. Hey, I wonder if, like Job, when his wife was pecking on him and telling him to curse God and die, that, and he didn't, that maybe if I'm in a similar situation and I realize the angels are watching to find out what I'm getting ready to do. It's not in my power to do it, which is why God put his life in me. But if I would let Christ live that life out through me, they will see the unbelievable wisdom of God in this area. And it's multifaceted. There's a whole bunch of different areas. When I get ready to do my taxes, and I could cheat and I could save myself some money and I could do that, the angels are watching. Forget the IRS. The angels are watching. And they're like, oh, you saved him. What's he going to do? And I realize I'm on display. That's why I'm here. I am here to be on display for God. I have learned this principle in my car. And since I've learned this principle, honest to goodness, I have allowed God to live through me in my car. I realize that when I'm in that car and there's people in front of me, I am on display, not to the people that are around me, but to the angels. And how I choose to live in that car, how I choose to drive in that car, what I choose to do in that car has God on display, whether it shows himself to be wise in sending his son or something else. Within a body of people, anytime you put a large group of people together, there's going to be bickerings, there's going to be disagreements, there's going to be all kinds of things. Whenever I've learned, hey, in the midst of all of those things, let me just take that. Because Jesus did. He said, Kenny, here's what you do when someone's crucifying you. Nothing. Say nothing. Do nothing. Do not defend yourself. Do not make excuse. If they want to curse you, spit on you, crucify you, defame you, let them for my sake. And if you're going to say anything, because he gave us the, tell us what to do. He said, say this, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And the angels will say, I don't get it. The church, the body of Christ, is so important. Let me close with this example. A number of years ago, when Steve Jobs was still alive, an Apple computer fell on some very difficult times for various reasons. They had kicked him out, and they hired him back. As a young chairman, Steve Jobs went to New York because he realized that they needed a new leader there, and he wanted somebody else to run the company. And so he went to PepsiCo and he sought after a man named John Sculley. And he wanted John Sculley to move to the West Coast to run that struggling company. They sat in Sculley's penthouse one day in the office. They were overlooking a Manhattan skyline, a beautiful skyline. And Sculley started to decline this offer that Jobs was making to him. And he said Apple would have to offer him, and he gave this ridiculous figure for a salary. He said, they have to offer me this kind of salary and benefit package. Well, Jobs took a deep gulp and he said, okay, we'll pay that. And Sculley had a hard time believing that he would even do that, but he did. But he says, I'll only pay that if you will commit to move to California. Sculley didn't want to do that. He didn't want to do it because he loved New York. And finally, Jobs was just overwhelmed. He was so flat. He says, do you want to spend the rest of your time selling sugared water, or do you want to change the world? Scully had never thought about what he was doing as changing the world. He was just making money. Many believers today don't commit themselves fully to the local church because they don't see the bigger picture. The church is at the center of how God has chosen to change his world. It is his eternal purpose to display himself through all of these local bodies. And we should respond by committing ourselves to praying for God to use us in his church mightily. We should be willing to endure hardship and struggle and challenge, as well as celebrate victory and overcoming and blessings and all those things. How would you and our church be today? How would we be different if we were to really grasp God's eternal purpose for us? What practical effect would it have on you? And I really want you to do this week. If you realize that every day that your behavior is being watched by the rulers in the heavenly places, and they are making determinations on who God is by how we respond to the indwelling Christ who lives within us as the body of believers, it may make a difference in how you live your life. Stand with me. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you today for your church. I thank you for your purpose. I didn't even scratch the surface of what this really means. It is beyond, almost beyond comprehension. But Father, if we can leave here today with at least one thing, let us leave with this. Your church is a little bit more important than maybe we had always known. It's not a country club. It's not a place to drop by to get our needs met. It is your chosen body with Christ as its head to manifest all of the things that there are to know about you to the principalities and the powers, the rulers in spiritual places. Even those of us who are here and other people can kind of see who you are. And it really depends much on how much we surrender to our head. You have chosen to pull all things together in one person, and that is Jesus Christ. And he has chosen us to be his body to help make that real. Father, if there's someone here who doesn't know Jesus and they need to be saved, I pray, Father, that they would not leave this building. There'll be people down front. There'll be people at the doors. There'll be people out of that red tent that are here who desire to help. May they not leave today without being prayed for, without being told about how to be saved, without grasping these truths. May you have your will and way in all that continues to go on from this day forward. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys. You're dismissed. Look forward to seeing you again next week.